Okay, welcome back again. On the last episode, we were speaking about better miners. You remember them? We were speaking about how better miners, they come before nouns, and to understand how to use them, we need to make sure that we understand nouns. So we have three different types of nouns. We have singular countable nouns, plural countable nouns, and uncountable nouns. Yeah, countable nouns, they can be singular or plural, and they are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Uncountable nouns, they don't have a plural form, and they don't have a plural form. So in the end, we have three types of nouns. It was important to know that because we were checking how some determiners only work with singular nouns, other determiners only work with plural nouns, other determiners only work with uncountable nouns. And then we have some things, for example, this with two, with both and neither. Sometimes uses plural, sometimes uses singular. So we need to know the rule, and we need to know what we're using in order to do it correctly. So I split this video in two because we're gonna keep moving, and this is like a kind of like a long class. There are many things that we have to speak about. We haven't even talked about time tenses and auxiliaries and stuff like that and verbs. Because again, before we start with that, before we start understanding how everything works in that regard, it is important that we know the basics first, okay? Now we know that English is not made by words. English is made by functions. And we were checking the functions and the words because functions and words are not the same. So it is really important for us to understand the name of every one of these things. And I know it seems like a lot of work, but believe me, this is super, super useful because once you understand the grammar behind it and how it works and the names and everything of it, you can use it to learn any language. You can learn Japanese or French or Italian or German or whatever. I mean, the more you know about this, the easier it's gonna be for you to learn any other language, including English. I mean, and this is something that we should have known about Spanish. We grew up speaking Spanish, but I think, I don't know, like the school system or something, there's a failure there because we graduate and we go out without even knowing what is a noun in our own language or what is a direct object or something like that. So all of this, it becomes, a veces siento que se convierte en responsabilidad de la, del maestro de inglés, del maestro del segundo y del tercer idioma enseñarnos gramática. Y por eso acabamos odiando los idiomas. Pero la verdad es que, pues, esa es una deuda que nuestros maestros de español nos dejaron, ¿sí? Porque la mayoría de nosotros no salimos de la escuela sabiendo cómo funciona nuestro propio lenguaje. Lo usamos por memoria, lo usamos porque nos acostumbramos, pues, porque estamos inmersos en él. Pero si no estamos dispuestos a sumergirnos en un segundo o en un tercer idioma, o si no tenemos el tiempo para hacerlo, pues entonces vamos a tener que aprender esto. Esta es la manera de hacer una especie de atajo, ¿ok? Esta es la manera en la que podemos llegar en relativamente poco tiempo de no saber nada a entender cómo funciona. Y otra vez, o sea, yo sé que todavía se los he dicho ya varias veces durante el curso, pero me gusta repetírselos porque creo quiero que les quede bien claro. En este curso vamos a ir desde el principio hasta el final, desde lo más fácil hasta lo más difícil. Y otra vez, esta no es una escalerita que hay que subir. No vamos a aprender una cosa y hasta que sean 100% perfectos en ella avanzar a la que sigue, y hasta que sean 100% perfectos en ella avanzar a la que sigue, porque así es como pasamos de nuestras clases de la secundaria a nuestras clases de la universidad viendo el mismo tema, porque nunca avanzamos. Aquí el chiste es, digamos que la manera en la que esto funciona es empezar desde el principio, llegar hasta el final. Van a tener dudas, yo lo tengo claro. Son algunas horas las que va a durar este curso. El video me estoy imaginando unas 14 horas más o menos. Pero al final de cuentas, eso no quiere decir que con verlo una vez uno ya aprende el idioma. Si yo fuera capaz de eso, pues ya lo estaría patentando y haciendo alguna cosa un poquito más lucrativa. Pero en realidad, ustedes lo van a ver, espero que les ayude a entender dónde cae cada cosa, y vamos a tener que seguir haciendo ejercicios y vamos a tener que verlo una vez y dos veces y tres veces y cuatro veces y hablar de específicos y corregir dudas, y al final Espero que les dé una mucho mejor idea de cómo funciona el idioma. Al final, esta es otra cosa que quería comentarles. Mucha gente se me acerca y me dice, oye, es que quiero un curso, es que la verdad me gusta mucho la clase, yo también estoy muy interesado, la verdad, bla, bla, bla. Yo nunca les creo que estén muy interesados en aprenderlo hasta que no los veo tratando de leer un libro en el idioma. ¿Sí? Ir a clases, hacer apuntes, poner los títulos bonitos, preocuparse por los quizzes. Pues es preocuparse por la escuela y está bien, o sea, está perfecto, también la cosa es pasar. Pero si alguien me dice que lo que le interesa es ser bilingüe, yo no le creo realmente hasta que no los veo leyendo un libro en otro idioma, haciendo cosas por gusto. O sea, tienes que integrarlo como una parte de tu vida, ¿sí? O sea, tienes que encontrar tiempo en las mañanas y en lugar de estar viendo, no sé, chismes o partidos de fútbol o cosas así en el iPad mientras desayunas, pues puedes poner algo que esté en inglés. O sea, los mismos chismes y los mismos partidos de fútbol, pero en inglés. Hay canales que lo hacen, muchísimos. Pero bueno. Okay, we're gonna continue. We're gonna move on. Excuse me for repeating myself over that. We're gonna move on with the next slide. We have it right here. We're gonna be speaking about this other determiner that is kind of, it is sometimes confusing for people. We have the determiner other and the determiner another. Yeah, we use determiners to say something about the noun that follows it. We have determiners other and another, but here too we need to pay attention to the type of noun that follows to make a good guess. Okay, again, other in Spanish, otro. Another in Spanish, otro. How do you know when to use this and when to use this? Again, you need to know the rules of English. In English, determiners, they come before nouns. Friends is a noun. Car is a noun. Before this noun, I use other. Before this noun, I use another. ¿Pueden observarlo y ver cuál es la diferencia? ¿Cuándo se usa other y cuándo se usa another? ¿Sí? Use other when I have a plural noun. Use another when I have a singular noun. ¿Se acuerdan que a y an solo funcionan con singulares? Pues es un poco lo mismo. A y an, another. I want another car. If I am speaking about a singular car, I want another car. If I am speaking about a plural thing, I want other cars, other friends. I need other friends. Plural, another friend, one more, not many more. This happens with countable nouns, we use other. With singular countable nouns, we use another. And then here, we have uncountable nouns. With uncountable nouns, it's a little different because the meaning can change a little bit. It says, with uncountable nouns, the meaning will change. Sometimes you need other money and sometimes you need another money, for example. This is going to be like a thing that you have to check case by case. You need to pay attention to how people speak and try to come up with what the difference is. But when you are using an uncountable noun, for example, this is uncountable, money, you don't say other money or you don't say another money. Well, you can use both other money or another money, but the meaning is going to be a little different. When you refer to other money, it is a different bill or a different coin or a different banknote. A coin, you know, like the piece of metal, the bill, the piece of paper, the thing that you keep on your wallet. When people, I don't know, maybe you have a bill and it's broken, it is kind of, it has a tear on its side or something. And maybe the person from the store tells you, the clerk, it tells you, do you have other money? Or, well, normally they will say another bill, but other money, it means a different piece of money. When you say another money, normally it means a different currency. Yeah, currency is the type of money. For example, euros or dollars or Mexican pesos or Colombian pesos or Brazilian reales, I think. So the thing with that is that when you say another money, people normally are speaking about a different currency. When you say other money, they are speaking about a different piece of the same money. For example, we have other water and another water. This is uncountable and this is uncountable. When you say other water, it means something like from a different source. Do you see any other water or other water? Other water is water from a different source, from a different place, from a different lake, a different pond, a different puddle, a different dam, a different ocean, a different whatever. I mean, I need other water, not this water. Maybe this water is very dirty or very unhealthy or whatever. I need other water, not this water. When you say another water, what you're meaning is that you have, for example, you have like a bottle of water and you need another water. It means another bottle of the same water, the same kind. I don't know, in Mexico, well, here, for example, we have Aguaciel or Bonafont or I don't know, many different brands. If you say, bring me another water, in reality, you should say, bring me another bottle. But when you say another water, it means one exactly the same. So with uncountable nouns, it's going to be a little bit case by case. You're gonna have to pay attention to how people use it, and you're going to have to just copy it. But it can be used in multiple ways. Again, we have here how to use other determiners: this, that, this, and those. We use determiners to speak about nouns, singular or plural, that are close to us or far away from us. It is a way to distanciate from some things and to separate them from others, okay? Maybe you know this, maybe you have seen this, but again, some people still have problems with it, so I think it is important to speak about it. We have this and that. These are for singular nouns, yeah? What is the meaning of this and that? This car, this is singular. This car, car is the noun, is singular. This car is blue, okay? It is conjugated in the singular. That car, singular again, is blue. We have the singular conjugation. It is the same thing. This and that, it is the same thing, but this is for things that are close to us, and that is for things that are away from us. This computer, it means the one I have in front of me. That computer, it means the one that is away from me. It is a way to separate them or to specify which one I am referring to. When you have plural nouns, you never use this. You use this. I mean, the pronunciation is going to be very similar. This is this, and this is this. To me, it is like when you say this, it's like you have like a serious face, like this. And when you say this, it's like you're smiling, this. If you're listening to a conversation on the phone or something, you may not really recognize the difference. But if they have a plural noun and the verb is conjugated in plural, you know that is with two E's, this. If they have a singular one with a singular pronunciation, you know this. This and this, okay? Don't worry too much about the pronunciation. Most people are not gonna notice if you're trying to say. Most people are going to know if you're speaking about this or this because of the rest of it. Are you using a singular noun? Are you using a plural noun? How are you conjugating the verb? For things that are far away from us, you use those. Those, it means plural, more than one, but far away from us. Those cars, not these cars, not the cars next to us. Those cars far away from us, they, plural, are, plural, blue. Those cars are blue. Again, as you know, subject, verb, and complement. The auxiliary will be in the simple present because this is an affirmative statement. You never use it, so whatever. We keep following the rules, okay? So. Let's move on. I hope this wasn't too quickly or too fast. I think this is something that you have checked before, but it is important that you know why or how they work. It's not just like Sesame Street, like this is far, this is away. But yeah, this, that, this, and those. Those are determiners that are very useful. Sorry. Let me just go back a little bit. Another important thing with this. The difference between this and that, it is something close to us and something away from us. But I think sometimes one mistake that we make is that we just think about it in a physical way, like this, I don't know, this house or that house. We normally only think about them like in a physical way. This house is the one close to me or the one I am in. That house is the other house away from me. But also another very important way that we use this is with time. If we are speaking about something in the present or something that is close to us in time, we use this. This day means today, because this is the day closer to us. If you're, for example, are speaking about memory, something that happened at a different time, something that you did 10 years ago, you don't say, this day was good. You say, that day was good. Why? Because it is in the past. Because it is in the past, this day is not close to us. It's far away from us. It's not physically far away. It's just away in time. Okay, so this is something that we do a lot, and this will be like a minor mistake, but it's kind of a mistake. This day means today. If you're not referring to today, don't say this day, say that day. If you're speaking about these days, it means the last week, the last couple of days, the last 3, 4, 5, 10 days. I mean, but the one closer to us. If we are speaking about the week that we spent in Cancun 10 years ago, oh, those days were good. Those days, because it is not only close to us in a physical way, but also close to us in time, or far away from us, not only in a physical way, also in time. Okay, so that will be it. And now we're gonna move on to something a little different, which is quantifiers. I told you we were gonna be checking determiners and quantifiers, and both of them are very similar. Well, I will say that quantifiers are a type of determiner, but how do you use them? Again, you need to pay attention to the nouns. We have countable nouns. Let me just mark them here. We have countable nouns and we have uncountable nouns. Sometimes if we have a countable noun, we're gonna use a specific determiner. If we have uncountable nouns, we're gonna use a different determiner, okay? So, again, we have two types. We have, we're speaking about big amounts, or we're speaking about small amounts. Amount is a quantity. Estamos hablando de cantidades grandes o cantidades pequeñas. ¿De qué? De cosas contables o de cosas incontables. When we have countable nouns and we have a big amount, we can use many, a lot of, lots, a lot of, lots, or many of. Cualquiera de estos sirve para hablar de cantidades grandes de sustantivos contables. Apples es un sustantivo contable. Chairs es un sustantivo contable, está en plural. Dogs es un sustantivo contable, está en plural. Things es un sustantivo contable, está en plural. Todos estos están en plural. If I want to express a big amount of them, si quiero expresar que tengo una cantidad grande de cualquiera de estas cosas, puedo usar many. I have many apples. Many es un determiner que está diciendo algo sobre las manzanas. ¿Qué está diciendo? Que están en gran cantidad. I have many apples. O también puedes decir, I have a lot of apples. I have lots of apples. I have many. Bueno, many of tiene aquí un pequeño asterisco. Ahorita les recuerdo cuando se usa many of. Pero estos tres, many, a lot, or lots. A lot of, perdón, con el of. Acuérdense, esto es importante. O lots, cualquiera está bien. I have many apples. I have a lot of apples. I have lots of apples. Maybe we are making a question. Did you buy a lot of chairs? Did you buy many chairs? Did you buy lots of chairs? Or, yeah, I think lots of, puede ser. Ahorita checamos. Lots of dogs. I don't want lots of dogs. Yo no quiero montones de perros. Yo no quiero muchos perros, ¿sí? Entonces decimos, I don't want lots of dogs. I don't want a lot of dogs. I don't want many dogs. Cualquiera de esos funciona. ¿Cuándo usamos many of? ¿Se acuerdan cuando se usaba el of como parte del determiner? many of. ¿Sí? Si vieron el capítulo anterior, el video anterior, donde estábamos hablando de los otros determiners, recordarán que cuando tenemos un segundo determiner, este determiner está hablando de things. Este otro determiner completo está hablando también de things. Cuando tenemos un segundo determiner, como your, or the, or my, no de, o these, or those, or another, or other, many of. ¿Sí? No es solo many. I got many of your things. Tengo muchas de tus cosas. No nada más I got many your things. Si no tuviéramos el your, entonces podríamos decir nada más I got many things. Y ya estuvo. ¿Sí? Recuerden que estamos usando el of porque hay un segundo determiner. Esto es para cantidades grandes. ¿Qué pasa con las cantidades pequeñas? Con las cantidades pequeñas, otra vez contables, tenemos few, a few, y a few of. Otra vez con su asterisquito, ya se imaginarán por qué. We have a subject, the auxiliary is do, we don't use it, verb, the verb is have, and the complement is this, few apples. Apples es un sustantivo y es plural. Recuerden que aunque sean cantidades pequeñas, siempre son plurales. Tengo unas pocas manzanas, significa más de una. Si tengo una manzana, no puedo usar a few or few. Few or a few significan pocas, pero significan más de una. ¿Sí? No puedo usar singulares. Solo están plurales contables, plurales e incontables. Singulares aquí realmente no hay. Para singulares, pues uso de, uso a, uso otras cosas. No estoy hablando de grandes cantidades. Los singulares siempre son una sola cantidad, uno. Entonces, aquí, aunque sean pocas, siempre van a ser plurales. Apples, plural noun. Minutes, plural noun. Insects, plural noun. ¿Cómo le hacemos? Si queremos hablar de una cantidad pequeña, a small amount, then we say, I have few apples, or I have a few minutes. A few, a few, or a few is the same. You use it, whatever, depending on what you want to do. It is the same meaning. I have few apples. I have a small quantity, a small amount of apples. Do you need a small amount of minutes? Do you need a few minutes? Do you need 3, 4, 5 minutes? A little amount, not too big. Is it okay? So we are saying few or a few. When do you think we use a few of? This is the determiner and it is speaking about insects. Why? Because we have another determiner. We have a second determiner. So we don't say, I need a few those insects. We say, I need a few of those insects. Necesito algunos, unos pocos de esos insectos. Esto está diciendo aquellos que están lejos. Es un segundo determiner. Este nos está diciendo que están lejos y que es plural. Este nos está diciendo que unos pocos nada más. I need a few of those insects. Necesito unos pocos de esos insectos. ¿Sí? Then we have uncountable nouns. Esto pasa nada más con countable nouns. ¿Pero qué pasa cuando tenemos uncountable nouns? ¿Qué pasa si ahora ya no estoy hablando de manzanas o sillas o perros o cosas o insectos o minutos? ¿Qué pasa si estoy hablando de agua, de dinero, de sal, de amor, de paciencia, de aceite o de arena? Esos sustantivos son sustantivos incontables. Entonces no voy a usar nunca ni many, ni a few, bla, bla, bla. Aquí lo que podemos ver es que cuando tenemos a big amount, if we have a big amount of uncountable nouns, we can use much, we can use a lot of, we can use lots, and we can use much of. If you realize, si se dan cuenta, tanto este de aquí como este de acá, se pueden repetir. Si no quieren meterse en broncas, usen a lot of o lots. Me parece que es más común lots of, para dejarlo aquí un poquito más claro. ¿Sí? A ver, vamos a... lots of. Si quieren usar cualquiera de estos dos, no van a tener problemas con contables o con incontables. Much solo es para incontables. Much of solo es para incontables. Many solo es para contables. Many of solo es para contables. So, I need much water. Water, uncountable. Do you have a lot of money? Money, uncountable. She didn't bring lots of salt. Salt, uncountable. I don't have much of that love. Love, uncountable. ¿Ok? Cuando tenemos incontables, ¿qué necesitamos? Necesitamos no many, but we need to use much. I need much water. Much water is a large amount of water, a big amount of water. Yeah, not just a little water, just not just like a liter or just a few drops. I need like a bucket or maybe more. I need much water. Do you save a lot of money? Remember, a lot of can be used with countable or with uncountable. A lot of money is, you know, again, money is uncountable, but you can say a lot of money. Do you have a lot of money? I have a lot of money. I have much money. You don't say I have many monies. That's impossible. Money is not, it cannot be plural. Monies doesn't exist. So we have, she didn't bring lots of, again, lots of, I think it's lots of instead of lot. Lots of, and then salt. Salt is uncountable. You never say salts. ¿Sí? No son muchas sales, es mucha sal. Ella no trajo mucha sal. You can say lots of salt, a lot of salt, or much salt. But you never say many salt or many of salt. Eso es imposible. We have much and we have much of. Love es incontable. ¿Por qué creen que le agregamos el of y que es much of? La misma regla de siempre. Porque tenemos un segundo determiner. Este determiner habla de ese amor. Y este está diciendo mucho de ese amor. I don't have much of that love. De ese ahí que estamos viendo. A lo mejor es un perro lamiéndole la cara a alguien. Ah, no tengo mucho de ese amor. Sí tengo de otros. O no sé, alguna cosa así. Pero cuando tenemos un segundo determiner, we don't use much, we use much of. ¿Ok? And then we have small amounts of uncountable nouns. If we have a small amounts of uncountable nouns, we're going to use little, a little, or a little of. Aquí hay un problema. Este de a lot of y lots se pueden cambiar. Lots of funciona con singulares. Perdón, bueno, con contables. Lots of también funciona con incontables. A lot of funciona con contables. A lot of funciona con incontables. Estos están bien porque pues, nos permiten como un pequeño comodín que podemos usar cuando tenemos cantidades grandes. Cuando tenemos cantidades pequeñas, nos fregamos. Cuando tenemos cantidades pequeñas, no se pueden repetir. Few, a few, or a few of. Little, a little, or a little of. There is no wild card. No hay comodines, okay? So you have patience. You don't have patiences. Patiences doesn't exist. Patient is an uncountable noun. Does she have a little oil? Oil is uncountable. You never say oils. Sand, arena. You don't say sands. This is uncountable. Okay? So, if you have a small amount of something uncountable, you can say a little. I want little patience. Quiero un poco de paciencia. Not a big amount, just a small amount. I need a small amount of patience. Okay? In this case, again, this is uncountable. You can say a little. Instead of little, you can say a little. Again, this is optional. You say little or a little. Both of them are completely okay. Does she have a little or little oil? A little oil, it means a small amount, a small quantity of oil. ¿Tiene un poco de aceite? Un poquito, un chorrito, con esto que tenga. I don't need much oil, I only need a little oil, okay? We must get a little of that sand. In this case, we have a little of. Otra vez. ¿Por qué creen que esté el of? ¿Se dan cuenta esta palabra verde? Pues sí, esa palabra verde es un segundo determiner. Este determiner está hablando de la arena. Este otro también está hablando de la arena. Como tenemos dos determiners, no decimos little that. O no decimos, we must get little that sand. Decimos a little of that sand. ¿Ok? Necesitamos conseguir un poco de esa arena. De esa arena en particular. Y como, bueno, otra vez tenemos dos determiners. Entonces usamos a little of. I hope it's starting to make sense. We have this little part here. Again, as with the other determiners, we add of when we have a second determiner. If we have a second determiner like this, many of. A second determiner like this, much of. A second determiner, a few of. A second determiner, little off, okay? It is always the same thing. So let me move on. And we have enough and enough of. When do we use this? What is this? What is enough? What is enough of? Okay. Enough, it means sufficient. When you're speaking about enough anything, it means sufficient anything. If you have enough, I have enough, whatever, I have enough pens, it means I don't need more pens. I have enough time, it means I don't need more time. Enough, it means an adequate. It says we can use determiners to express quantities, saying that we have a big or a small, or in this case, an adequate amount of something. We need to know which kind of noun we have in order to use the proper determiner. When we want to communicate that the number of something we have is adequate, we use the determiners enough and enough of. Okay? Vamos a usar los determiners. Perdón, me fui uno por adelante. Enough y enough of. ¿Cómo funcionan esos? Bueno, aquí tenemos. Singular nouns. Sorry. Singular nouns, plural nouns, and uncountable nouns. The good thing about enough and enough of is that we normally use them with any noun. So for example, we say, I have enough. If you say enough, puede servir como si fuera un pronombre. La palabra enough, además de ser un determiner, puede servir como si fuera un pronombre. Cuando yo digo enough, significa yo tengo suficiente y no tengo que decir suficiente qué. Suficiente tiempo. ¿Sí? La única manera de que yo entienda que me refería a tiempo es que ya lo hubiéramos dejado claro. Nosotros estábamos hablando desde antes, tienes tiempo, no tengo tiempo, me falta tiempo. I have enough. Ok, ahí enough puede funcionar como un pronombre. ¿Sí? Cuando estamos hablando de sustantivos singulares, por ejemplo, no sé, enough, bueno, de cualquier tipo de sustantivo en realidad, podemos usar enough. I don't have enough. ¿Qué significa eso? No tengo suficiente. ¿Suficiente qué? Bueno, enough es el pronombre. Está en el lugar del sustantivo. No tengo suficiente dinero. Ya estábamos hablando de dinero, tú dinero, yo dinero, mucho dinero. I don't have enough. I don't have enough money. ¿Ok? Cuando hacemos preguntas, también podemos usarlo, ¿sí? Como un determiner, is it enough? Aquí estamos diciendo, ¿es suficiente? ¿Suficiente qué? Otra vez, este es un pronombre, no está diciendo suficiente qué. Si queremos decir qué, lo podemos decir. Is it enough time? Y acá ponemos, acá cerramos. No hay ningún problema. Podemos usarlo como un determiner, o podemos usarlo sin esto como un pronombre, ¿ok? Con pronombres plurales, we have enough apples. What is enough? Sufficient. I have enough apples. I don't need more. You don't have enough friends. If you have an affirmative or a negative statement, it doesn't matter. You don't have enough friends. I am saying that you don't have an adequate number of friends. You can also make it a question. Have we gotten enough potatoes? Have we gotten, hemos conseguido suficientes, an adequate amount of potatoes. Uncountable nouns, again, I want enough water. Enough, I don't have enough salt. Did we buy enough gasoline? Gasoline is uncountable, water is uncountable, salt is uncountable. Enough water, suficiente agua, enough salt, suficiente sal, enough gasoline, suficiente gasolina. Enough puede funcionar con plurales o con incontables. Cuando estamos hablando de singulares, realmente no funciona tanto con singulares, sino que está funcionando como pronombre. Cuando funciona como pronombre, ya no tiene allá adelante lo que tengamos. ¿Sí? Aquí también puedo hacer lo mismo. Did we buy enough gasoline? ¿Compramos suficiente gasolina? Si ya está entendido que estamos hablando de gasolina, pues puedo quitar este. Y aquí dice, did we buy enough? ¿Compramos suficiente? Y si ya teníamos un contexto, nosotros sabemos que nos referimos a gasolina. ¿Sí? Puede funcionar como si fuera un pronombre también. ¿Cuándo creen que se use enough of? Otra vez, enough normalmente no se usa con singulares, pues no se va a usar tampoco con singulares enough of. Pero con plurales y con incontables, adivinen cuándo usamos enough of. ¿Qué creen? Aquí este es un plural, enough of, y aquí tenemos un plural, enough of, y aquí tenemos un plural. ¿Por qué tenemos enough of en lugar de enough? Porque tenemos un segundo determiner, porque tenemos un segundo determiner, porque tenemos un segundo determiner. When we have a second determiner, we don't say, I have enough these apples. Because I have this second determiner, I need to say, I have enough of these apples. Tengo suficientes de estas manzanas. A lo mejor me faltan de otras. I don't know enough of your friends. No conozco suficientes de tus amigos. O sea, sí conozco mucha gente y suficientes amigos, pero de los tuyos, no conozco lo suficiente. Do we have enough of the keys? ¿Tenemos suficiente de las llaves? ¿De cuáles llaves? No sé, es una oración medio extraña, pero puede funcionar. Si tenemos incontables, again, we have enough of oil, enough of work, enough of sand. Oil is incontable, work is uncountable, and sand is uncountable. Okay, this is an affirmative statement, this is a negative statement, this is a question. They are exactly the same. Remember, subject, auxiliary, verb, and complement. The subject is, let me just do this here. The subject is I. The auxiliary is did. We don't use it because this is the simple past. The verb is got. And the complement is enough of that. If we want to make the sentence negative, what do we do? Very simple. We use subject. The auxiliary is necessary because it takes the negative, verb, and complement. So in this case, we have subject. The auxiliary is necessary because it takes the negative, the verb, and here we have the complement. If we need to make a question, instead of subject auxiliary, we need to change places. Auxiliary first, and then subject, and then verb, and then complement. So we have it here. Auxiliary first, subject, the verb, and all of this is the complement. But in the complement, we have enough of and then uncountable noun. Enough of and uncountable noun. ¿Por qué creen que tengamos enough of y después un incontable? ¿Por qué el of? ¿Se acuerdan? Porque hay un segundo determiner. ¿Cuándo hay of? Cuando hay un segundo determiner. Cuando hay un segundo determiner. Si no tenemos un segundo determiner, nada más enough water, enough salt, enough gasoline. Si tenemos un segundo determiner como that, the, o this, entonces es enough of. ¿Ok? Estos son algunos quantifiers, no son todos. Vamos a seguir checando algo de ellos. Vamos a pasar a la parte de some y any, que es muy importante porque se entrelaza con los pronombres indefinidos, que son una cosa que todavía no hemos checado, pero también son un poquito especiales, complicados. Entonces aquí vamos a cortar este video también para no tratar de dar mordidas tan grandes. Están quedando, de hecho, los videos un poco más largos de lo que esperaba. Espero que no les moleste, que no les aburra tanto. Otra vez, cualquier duda, cualquier comentario, cualquier cosa que necesiten, me pueden mandar un mensaje en el grupo que tenemos. Podemos también checar, guarden, escriban las oraciones que no entendieron bien, las cosas que les costaron trabajo, escríbanlas en una hoja de papel y guárdenlas para cuando tengamos la sesión virtual de clases. Y bueno, podemos checar específicamente cualquier ejemplo con el que tengan problemas. Si necesitan volver a ver el episodio, ponerle pausa, cualquier cosa, siempre pueden hacerlo. Recuerden que también les voy a pasar la presentación. A lo mejor hay partes que se tapan un poquito con la gráfica de mi, donde está mi rostro. No sé bien cómo controlar mucho eso. Entonces, de todas maneras, les estoy pasando la presentación para que tengan todo como yo lo estuve usando. ¿Ok? That's it for now. So, thank you very much. I'll see you on the next video.